is Mr. Salil Tripathi. Mr. Salil Tripathi is a contributing editor at The Caravan and The Mint and has written extensively on politics, economics, arts and business for more than 25 years for a wide range of publications, including The Wall Street Journal, Far Eastern Economic Review, The New Statesman and The Guardian. And he has been a senior correspondent of India Today. He has received numerous awards for journalism. Mr. Tripathi is an author of Offense, The Hindu Case, and The Colonel Who Would Not Repent, The Bangladesh War and Its Unquiet Legacy. His collection of travel writing will be published by Westland Trancobar in early 2015. We invite Mr. Salil Tripathi to share his views on the book. We would also introduce the author of the book, Ms. Arshia Sattar, whose translation of the Valmiki Ramayana, Tales from Katha Sarita Sagar, and her collection of essays on the Ramayana have been published by Penguin Books. Her book, Lost Loves Exploring Rama's Anguish, was shortlisted for the Crossword Nonfiction Award in 2012. She has also written three books for children. Ms. Sattar teaches classical Indian literature at various institutions across the country and, along with D.W. Gibson, is the founder and director of Sangam House, an international writers' residency program located outside Bangalore. We request Mr. Salil Tripathi and Ms. Arshia Sattar for their discussion on the book Lost Loves.
Good morning, everyone. It's a great pleasure here to be here today with Arshia, who I've known from a time so long that some of the children here weren't born then, right? Yes, that's right. We were at college together in Bombay. And she's done fantastic work with Hindu mythology and literature, and it's been a real pleasure having known her all these years. So, how do we first come across the story of Ramayana, the Sanskrit epic that Hindus revere? Maybe we see a melodramatic performance in a public ground, or perhaps we read the comic books of Amar Chitra Katha. We sit through interminable soap opera of Ramanan Sagar, or we read a textbook-like version of Chakravarti Rajagopalchari, or perhaps we are lucky enough to hear the stories at the feet of our grandparents. Urban or rural, Hindu or not, the Ramayana is likely to intrude on the life experience of any Indian to the extent that nobody needs to be told the story. It's like what critic Ashish Rajadaksha called an epic. Epic is something everyone knows the beginning, the middle and the end, and still people go for it because it's not the story that matters but the telling of it that matters, and the truths and messages that are interpreted again and again and reinforced, that's what matters. The remarkable thing is that the bare bones of its narrative apart, Ramayana lays itself open to myriad interpretations, and one of the finest interpreters of our time is Arshia. She approaches the Ramayana as a great stream in which the reader can dip in and out, each time uncovering new meanings with layers of explanations wrapped around individual actions. In Lost Loves, which is a short collection of interwoven essays about Ramayana and its central characters, she explores what drove individuals at the heart of the epic to act the way they did. She is eminently qualified for such an intellectual inquiry. She translated it first in Sanskrit, from Sanskrit in 1996, and did not camouflage the text by using any euphemism. She laid bare the nuanced dilemmas there, and in the new collection of essays, she mediated on the individual decisions and how they were made. This was published in 2011. Why did Dashrath allow his love for Kaikeyi to trump his duty towards Ram? Why did Ram require Sita to undergo the trial by fire, even when he trusted her? This division between the personal anguish and public duty is at the heart of her inquiry. She reflects on Ram's pain and vulnerability, making him human. She also shows Sita's firmness, reminding us that she wasn't a docile character. What she brings to the epic tale is a refreshing and eclectic scholarship, and the story is something that many Indians, regardless of their faith, consider holy. That means it gets placed on a pedestal, and most people end up knowing about a little about it, but beyond the basic plot. She probes deeply into the motivations and actions of the characters, psychoanalyzing and humanizing them, while recognizing the solace that the characters provide to the devout. Hindu gods and goddesses are kept on an elevated plane, but she reminds us that they are sometimes unaware of their powers. They can act nobly and sometimes, because of their flaws, harshly. Think here of Amit Chaudhary's short story about the physical mutilation of Shurpanakha. There are many interpretations and variations of the Ramayana precisely because India is a pluralistic society and no singular view prevails. It is the messiness of that pluralism that Hindutva activists do not like. The transformation of Ram into a monolithic icon is a recent political project which culminated in the destruction of the Babri Masjid in 1992. As a correspondent at India Today many years ago, I had interviewed the former Prime Minister Morarji Desai, who lived in retirement at a seafront apartment in Bombay. Desai had written about Hinduism and he was troubled by the agitation. With characteristic bluntness, he told me, "They," and by "they" he means the Hindutva activists, "are making Hinduism into what it is not. They want a pluralistic faith to become monotheistic, with one book, Ramayana, one holy place of worship, Ayodhya, and one God to revere, Ram." That to him was not Hinduism. Within 3 years of our conversation, a Hindu mob had raised the Babri Masjid, transforming a multi-layered relationship between the devotee and the divine into a simplistic hierarchical arrangement was one of the major successes of the Ram Janmabhoomi movement. The Hindutva project wanted a simpler narrative. In 2008, the University of Delhi prescribed the essay by the late poet A.K. Ramanujan called 300 Ramayanas, 5 examples and 3 thoughts in translation. The students' wing of the Bharatiya Janata Party, Akhil Bharatiya Vidyarthi Parishad, stormed the history department, protesting against blasphemy, a notion that is alien to Hinduism. Also, in a project to deepen the water separating India and Sri Lanka had been held up, in part because Hindu nationalists opposed it. They claimed that the construction in that area would destroy a mythical bridge built by Ram and his warriors to help his attack in Sri Lanka. Ram's suspicion, which questions Sita's integrity and purity, has long angered feminists, including me, and baffled more sensible readers among Ram's devotees. As one travels across the vast Indian nation, the stories change, sometimes subtly and sometimes drastically. Villains appear human, heroes acquire feet of clay. The doyen of Indian history, Romila Thapar, says that embedded in Ramayana's many versions are stories that reflect the social aspirations and ideological concerns of each group that has propounded a different version. And beyond India, it's a fascinating story. I've seen Ramayana episodes on the walls of temples in Prambanan in Yogyakarta. The walls of Bangkok's temple of the Emerald Buddha, Wat Phra Kyaw, show scenes from the Thai version of Ramayana, which varies greatly from the grand narrative that we know in India. There is a Ramayana Kakavin in Jakarta, in Java, Ramakirti in Cambodia, Ramakien in Thailand, Pralak Pralam in Laos, and Hikayat Sarirama in Malaya. In the Malay version, Lakshman emerges as a brave brother. Ram is weak and occasionally abusive, and Ravana is a descendant of Adam. In some Thai versions, Ram is Buddha, and Ravan his cousin. In the Cambodian Ramayana, which I saw in Siem Reap, Hanuman, the monkey god, emerges as a playboy instead of a bachelor devoted to Rama. In certain Balinese versions, such as Kechak, bare-chested men hauntingly chant chak 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 as they dance around a bonfire. It's a very rich tradition. In the 1990s, when the Singapore Asian Civilizations Museum organized an exhibition of Southeast Asian interpretation of Ramayana, its curator was a woman called Gauri Parimu Krishnan, and she wrote this: "Valmiki's Ramayana has been wrongly ascribed a canonical status, giving rise to a sort of patriarchal, literal, illiterate, pan-Indian elitism which in recent times has been scorned. There is also the film by Nina Paley called Sita Sings the Blues, which is worth watching on the YouTube. Other feminist writers, Nabanita Devsen, and at one time when she was a full-blooded feminist writer, Madhu Kishwar, have written about Ramayana and its interpretation very well. A Ramayana like Nina Paley's, which actually treats Sita not as a docile and obedient housewife, but as an assertive woman who is feminine but not feminist, is part of the tradition. Yet this version destabilizes the activist's notion of the ideal manhood even more. Beyond India, the story gets transformed, as we saw. And within India, it's a point about the whole issue about playfulness being seen as weakness, is what Marsha Nussbaum writes astutely in her study of Hindutva, The Clash Within, Democracy, Religious Violence, and India's Future. Ram's overt masculinity troubles several academics, and we have seen in these films and in these plays questions being raised about it. In India itself, there is a tradition of Sitayan, which is looking at Ramayan through the eyes of a woman, through the eyes of Sita. And besides, there is also the whole story. This is not just about Ramayan. We will talk a bit about Mahabharata too. You can't do that. And the standard bearer in that field is, of course, Iravati Karu as Yugant. It is in that lively tradition of critical commentary and reinterpretation that Arshia has written this book, Lost Loves, which is about the love story within Ramayan. And that's where it resides. She has reclaimed the Ramayan. Sita is a woman of substance, and Ram, torn by conflicting notions of duty, is trying to get it right. And in his failure and crushing personal defeats, we understand the meaning of our lives. If we see Ram as one of us, Ramayana becomes more poignant, a story that explores the human condition rather than one that stridently declares the unimpeachable nature of divinity. This is what she has written. That may not fit the Hindutva project, but she brings the epic closer to its spirit. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you, Salil. That was very eloquent and quite flattering. So thank you for that. I'm going to read from the end of the Yuddhakanda in Valmiki, because it's when Rama, when Sita is expecting to be reunited with her husband, who she hasn't seen for so long and whom she has pined for. And it's that passage really upon which the whole of Lost Loves is predicated. Because Lost Loves, as Salil was saying, is a series of interlocking essays, but the premise of Lost Loves is that whatever else the Ramayana is, and it is many, many things, it is also a love story, and it's a very tragic love story. It's about not losing the person that you love, which is one kind of tragedy, but losing your love for the person that was the center of your life, which is another kind of tragedy, and perhaps a far greater one. So I'm going to read, the war is over, Ravana has been killed, there's much rejoicing among the monkeys, rather less rejoicing among the Rakshasas. And Sita is waiting to see Rama, and to her surprise, after all these, we don't know whether it's months or years, but it's a very long time after this very long period of separation, she's expecting that Rama will come to her and that their reunion will be private and intimate. But instead, Rama asks her to come out onto the battlefield. And there's this mob that's trying to reach Sita. And Vibhishana is very agitated and he's trying to control the crowds. And Rama says, Rama's eyes blazed with anger as he said to Vibhishana, "Why are you going against my wishes and treating these people so harshly? Stop it. Immediately. These are my people. A woman's behavior is what protects her modesty, not a home, nor fine clothes, nor high walls, or honors such as these. Women can be seen in public in times of calamities and emergencies, in times of war, at their own weddings, and at religious rituals. A war has just been fought on Sita's account. She faces a crisis in her life. There is nothing wrong if she's seen in public, especially in my presence. Bring Sita here quickly, Vibhishana. Let her see me surrounded by all my friends." So Vibhishana goes to fetch Sita, and she's not allowed to change her clothes. You know, she says, "Can I just put on my jewelry?" And he's like, no, you've got to come the way you are. And of course, you know, she's been sitting with the one plait, and she's wearing these soiled garments, which, you know, is very resonant of Draupadi being pulled out into the Sabha. But of course, Draupadi's soiled garments are from menstrual blood. Sita's are not. Deeply embarrassed and shrinking into herself, Sita approached her husband, followed by Vibhishana. When she found herself in the presence of such a huge crowd, she covered her face in shame and she whispered, "Noble one." She gazed at her beloved husband, who was like a god to her, and her face lit up with love, pleasure, and wonder. Her weariness and sorrow fell away the moment she saw her husband's moon-bright face, which she had not seen for so long. Rama looked at Sita standing meekly by his side, and he gave vent to the anger in his heart. "I have killed the enemy, my dear, and I have won you back. In doing so, I have displayed the courage expected of me. I have avenged the insult, and it no longer bothers me. I have destroyed the enemy and the disgrace together. I have displayed my prowess and achieved my goals. I have kept my promises. Now I am free. You were carried off by a restless Rakshasa while you were alone with no one to protect you. I, a mere mortal, have redressed that wrong decreed by fate. I have done my duty by rescuing you from the enemy and avenging the insult to myself. You should know that this war, which was won by the heroic efforts of my friends, was not fought for your sake. I did it to vindicate my honor and to save my noble family from disgrace. I have terrible suspicions about your character and conduct. The sight of you is as painful to me as a lamp is to a man with diseased eyes. You are free to go wherever you want. The world is open to you. I have no more use for you, Sita. How can a man born into a noble family lovingly take back a woman who has lived in the house of a strange man? I am proud of my noble lineage. How can I take you back when Ravana has touched you and when you have lived under his lustful gaze? I have regained my reputation. That was the sole motivation for rescuing you. I do not want you anymore, Sita. You can go where you like. You can go to Lakshmana, or to Bharata, or to anyone else who pleases you, to Sugriva, the king of the monkeys, or to Vibhishana, the king of the Rakshasas. Go wherever you want."
Thanks, Arshia. I have questions about exactly this sort of episode, but I want to go back a little bit to the beginning about what you talk about in your prologue. In the prologue, what Arshia says is that she wrote this translation. It was published in 1996, which, as I alluded to earlier, was 4 years after the destruction of the Babri Masjid. And she's candid in her introduction to Lost Love here, that after she wrote it, she felt, of course, a relief, sense of exhaustion that comes in after such a big project. But she also felt it was a very troubled time for India, because it was also around that time that the first NDA government came to power and the politics of India changed. And the politics of India changed to the extent of making this valorized one book, one God, one holy place kind of mythology about Hinduism more prevalent and more public and as the only truth, as it were. And you were despaired by that, and you didn't really go back to it, didn't really look at it for a few years. And you went back to it again a few years ago, and the result is the Lost Love. Moment of jubilation. But now we are again in the same period, after last May, where the same kind of politics is back again. So how do you reflect in your relationship with the text and with the relationship with the politics of India?
Well, I think the first time around, you know, with the first rise of Hindutva in the late 80s and the early 90s, I think people, you know, leftists, secular, liberals, you know, people like us, we were just not prepared for what happened. And you were sort of sitting around and saying, it'll never happen in India. Oh, we are so pluralistic. Oh, we're so safe. Now we know that it can happen and it does happen. So I think in a way, we're more prepared this time to offer multiple kinds of resistances to this kind of hegemonic flattening, homogenizing principle that seems to be at work. In terms of the text, I think what happened to a lot of us in the 90s, many of us who'd worked with Ramayana were just so terrified of being associated with Hindutva that we gave up the text completely. We abandoned the text and we abdicated all the public spaces where we could have claimed the text. That's finished. I mean, we've all reclaimed Ramayana. Not all of us, many of us have reclaimed Ramayana. And you know, once you reclaim something, you're less likely to give it up without a fight. I mean, the last time we were just so shocked, it's like, oh my God, I'm not involved with this, you know? So I think we're sharper, I think we're more battle-weary, and hopefully I think we're more strategic this time. I'm certainly feeling much braver than I was 20 years ago, you know? I'm also 20 years older, so I have less to lose. You know, as a 36-year-old, you think, oh, I don't want somebody to come and break my house. Now at 54, I'm going to break my house, you know, come, show me your face, you know? That's that I really feel strongly about, so.
And I assume that that display of valor is inspired by the new Ram, is it?
Inspired by what?
By the new Ram.
Yes, yeah, of course, the warrior, yeah.
The warrior king, indeed. My next question was really about one writer that you refer to and allude to at the beginning of the book again, and this is Shulman, David Shulman. And you come up with a very interesting proposition which made me think again about my relationship with Ramayana, because card-carrying liberal as it were, I thought that Ram was a terrible guy, you know, that he was treated his wife so badly.
Which he did.
Shurpanakha badly, and he was obedient to beyond what was necessary, didn't assert himself, didn't, and those were the kind of views I had. And how could you worship him? How could you put him on a pedestal? That's the way I used to see it. And then you come up with this observation of Shulman, which also guides your thinking and your approach to the book, where you say that, look, actually, he had glimpses of divinity. He himself wasn't aware when he was divine, but there were times when he really acted in a divine manner, and when there were times when he did not act like a divine manner. What was majority, what was not, is a matter of debate. Whether the person should be put upon a pedestal is a matter of debate. But therefore, you see, saw him in a more sympathetic light. And in a way, most people that were put upon a pedestal would fall in that kind of a category. And the obvious example I think of is Gandhi. You know, because we do kind of revere him at a level where you put up pick every currency note as his photograph, we put him up, name roads after him and so on. And, you know, even currently the Swachh Bharat Andolan is the only thing he seems to have done for India. Is that the mythology that's coming about him? And at the same time, there are genuine questions about his relationship with women, the way he treated Kasturba and so on. So I just wanted you to explore more of this notion of partial divinity.
Right. For me, I don't think the question is one so much of partial divinity, but I think it's partial remembering. And I'm getting very interested in this idea of remembering and forgetting as a trope in Indian storytelling, because one of the things that happens in Ramayana over and over again is people forget who they are, right? Hanuman doesn't know that he can leap over the ocean, and Jambavan has to say to him, hey, you can do it. And Hanuman is like, me? Really? And Jambavan says, well, don't you know who you are? And Hanuman says, no, tell me. And, you know, he's reminded, and then he can cross the ocean. And so, astounding that Rama asked the same question at the end of the Agni Pariksha, when all the gods come down and they say, oh Rama, you know, you should take Sita back, blah 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 blah, and because don't you know who you really are? And he says, yeah, I know who I am. I'm Rama, son of Dasharatha. And they're like, no, you're not. You're a god. And he's like, oh, right. You know? And then, of course, also the sort of frame story of the Valmiki Ramayana is that Rama is listening to his own story being told to him by his sons, who are twins and who look exactly like him. And everybody in the, you know, at the Yajna is like, oh, they look just like Rama, oh, they're so handsome. And Rama's listening to this story. And at one point he says, and whose story is this? And the point at which he asks that question is when he's told by his sons that the man whose story they're telling banished his pregnant wife into the forest. And he says, who are you talking about? And he said, this is your story, Rama. And he's like, really? Is your mom still around? Can we get her back? And, you know, and then a whole other thing proceeds. So this idea that you need to be reminded who you are, and when you are reminded, what you do with that knowledge, yeah, do you grow into it as Hanuman does, literally and figuratively, or like Rama, are you bewildered and you need to sit back and say, oh wow, okay, this is who I am now, how do I behave? So the idea of Rama having flashes of recognition of himself, who he really is, I think is very, very interesting, because when he does these deeds that make us really uncomfortable, which is the killing of Vali, the mutilation of Shurbanaka, the banishment of Sita, and later in Uttarakhanda, the killing of Shambhuka, the low caste, the Shudra, who's performing tapasyas that are only meant for Brahmins. When he does these things, the question is, at that moment, is he remembering that he's God, or at that moment, is he remembering that he's human? You know, because if he acts as a human being, we judge him or we respond to him in a particular way. But if he does these bad things when he remembers that he's God, then we have a completely different response to the idea of God, to the theology of Rama, to the sort of religious values almost of the Ramayana. Yeah, so it's very important for you to make that decision. Is he acting as a man when he behaves badly, or is he acting as a God? And I don't think somebody should tell you that. I think every individual needs to figure that out for themselves.
And I was just going to come on that point, that you are placing too much of a burden on the reader in a way, and not you. I mean, this goes back to Valmiki in a sense, that, you know, to make these interpretations and decisions, because the reader is required or expected to approach the book as a holy book, which is unquestionable and where there is some sort of an eternal, ineffable truth. And what you are saying, and what makes a lot of sense, is that actually he was a character, a human character, with glimpses of divinity, or throughout he was probably divine, but it always remains subconscious. And maybe that is the larger message, that all of us have that divine within us, which remains subconscious, and it is for up to us to bring it up. Yeah. And it places a lot more effort. And the whole narrative, the way it has been hijacked now, or being reshaped now, to put it in a more polite way, actually argues that no, this is it, and this is right, and if this is indeed the way the Maryada Purushottam acts, this is the way you should also act. And so the interpretation becomes literal rather than liberal, and people start questioning their spouses and so on.
Yeah. But it's very important also to remember that I'm talking only about Valmiki's text. And that's a very, very crucial text, because it's the only non-bhakti Ramayana that we have. It was composed and put together at a time when bhakti had not become the central emotion of Hinduism. Right?
Can you just elaborate a bit on that, about the bhakti and the two khands that come later? I think it's important here.
Yeah. So we believe that the central part of the Valmiki Ramayana consists of 7 khandas. And it's very clear that Balakanda, that's the first khanda, and Uttarakhanda, that's the last khanda, are written later. Very, very clear, for reasons that to scholars are just like apparent, right? The language is different, the politics are very, very different. The kind of world that is represented in Khanda 1 and Khanda 7 is not the kind of world that is represented in the middle khandas. Ayodhya Khanda opens with a completely plausible story of a palace intrigue of a stepmother who wants her son to be king in place of the heir apparent. The Bala and Uttarakhandas were added on to what we call Valmiki's text. Of course, you know, Valmiki is also a construct. After bhakti became so central to Hinduism. Sort of at the same time that bhakti is becoming important, we also have the development in Vaishnava theology of avatars. And basically what Vaishnava theology was doing at the time was they were adding to their cachet all the attractive characters that they found in mythology. So whether it's Vamana or Narasimha or Krishna. So we actually have 2 Ramas only in Valmiki. Right, we have the Rama who acts like a human being in the middle books, and then we have the divinized Rama who is present in book one and book seven. And of course, book one and book seven are the frame that come much later. So they're constructed with a particular agenda. And the next Ramayana, the next story of Rama that we have, we believe that the Valmiki text was composed in its current form with the extra khandas no later than 300 of the Common Era. The next Ramayana we have is Kamban in Tamil, and that's 12th century. So a millennium has gone by. Bhakti has been established as the sort of heart. The beating heart of Hinduism now lies in bhakti. Buddhism has been defeated. Jainism has been pushed to the borders, to the edges of coastal India. Hinduism is on the rise, and that is when we have Rama coming out as an avatara. And after that, every single Ramayana, every single classical Ramayana is a bhakti Ramayana, right? Now, when for me, these Ramayanas are beautiful. I mean, Kamba Ramayana is exquisite. The Sundara Kanda of Kamba Ramayana, people read it just because they want to cry, because it's so beautiful. You know, Manas controls the imagination of, you know, 180 million people in northern India. These are very, very important texts. But for me, I find bhakti a narrative dead end. Yeah, because if somebody is God, whether he's Rama or Krishna, what's the question? You know? You can say to God, why did you do this? And God will say, I did it for your good. Oh, but it doesn't seem that way. And God will say, oh, you have a limited mind. You know, there's no dialogical way to either deepen your understanding of faith or, you know, expand your understanding of narrative logic, you know. So I'm sorry, that was a very long answer.
No, it was a good one. This is a hard question to ask you because you're an old friend, but I have to ask, so I'm going to ask you that if people were to read your name, they would assume you're a Muslim. That's the assumption they will make. You cite Shulman, who is a Jewish scholar. You then go and you're a student of Wendy Doniger, who at least currently the moral arbiter of this country is a man called Dinanath Batra, and he doesn't seem to like her writing very much. And the current Prime Minister happens to quote from him and takes it very seriously. In that kind of a scenario, what kind of a relationship can you have? Do you see yourself as an outsider to the story? Or do you think it's a ridiculous question?
Okay, while you're citing all my Mlecha teachers, you must also remember that I was taught by the greatest Brahmin of them all, A.K. Ramanujan, you know, who could not be more Brahminical, who could not be more within the tradition of commentary and, you know, translation and tika and everything like that. You know, I have to say, until you said it out like this, I didn't realize that I was in the company of Mlechas and that we were really quite far outside the boundaries that this text establishes for itself. Not just the text, but the tradition establishes for itself. But it's important to remember that it's always been outsiders who have questioned the Ramayana, whether it's Periyar, 20th century Tamil Nadu, or Dalit Ramayanas, or Gond Ramayanas, even the Bengali Ramayana, Kirtibasa, which is a classical Ramayana, questions some of the things that happen. Is Hanuman is not a brahmachari for Kirtibasa. He's, you know, full-blooded and very lustful. So it's obviously people who feel excluded that knock on the door, right? So I think it's very important that people like us, who are considered by the tradition to be outsiders, that we keep asking the questions. But we ourselves don't see ourselves as outsiders at all. I have a right to this text. Everybody has a right to this text. Why should it belong to one set of people and not to anybody else? So nobody is an outsider. And sadly, I find it really strange that I'm going to use a word used by Rajiv Malhotra, my sworn enemy, because he believes in inside. He uses the word gatekeepers. And my problem is that the Ramayana has got locked up inside a very unpleasant gated community at this moment. You know, it's a community that's not letting other people in. It's like, you know, well, storm the Bastille, you know, it's my text too.
Indeed it is, and to lay my cards on the table, thank you for doing this. Because I wanted someone to reclaim it for the rest of us. and you've done that, and I'm glad you have stormed the Bastille. But let's go back to some of the things that make people question Ram and his divinity. The three episodes, Sita, Vali and Shurpanakha. Does it anger you, these three stories? I mean, you see the flawed aspect of his decision making and the choices he made.
No, I think I've gone past my anger with Rama. I spent a lot of time being angry with Rama. And it was sort of very much, you know, part of being a feminist in the 90s, being a feminist in my 30s, I'm still a feminist. But I don't feel angry with Rama anymore. I just think like, oh my God, how confused must you have been? How much pain were you going through? How clouded could your judgment be? How could you lose sight of your better self so terribly? And that's a question that we can ask any one of ourselves. It's not a question for God. It's not a question for a king. It's just, and I think that, no, so I'm not angry with him anymore. But it still distresses me terribly. I mean, when I read the passage that I just shared with you of how he talks to Sita, my hair stands up. You know, I get goose flesh. It's a very, very difficult passage to read. I mean, the violence in it is astounding. Even though he hasn't touched her, he hasn't laid a finger on her, but this, you know, and he says to her, go to whoever you want. He says, pick my brothers, pick the king of the monkeys. I mean, how cruel. And then I think how unhappy Rama must have been to be that cruel to somebody else. Because that's the only way I have of understanding my own emotional cruelty to people that I love. I'm really unhappy. And so I want somebody else to be miserable too.
The other great epic we have not yet spoken. I'll have just two more questions, then I'm going to take it out. Yeah, or make it open. The other great epic which we've not really talked about, Mahabharata. And again, the cliche understanding in India is that you read Ramayana to learn how you should act, but you don't keep Mahabharata in the house because it will create conflict. And that's the way people have seen it. And at that level, it seems Ramayana is a simple tale of good and evil, and Mahabharata is way too nuanced that everyone has shades of gray. Is that a fair characterization? And
no. When I started working on Ramayana in graduate school, I used to feel very uncool, like, oh my God, you know, the big text is Mahabharata, and I'm such a coward, I'm taking the easy text, and I'm taking the text that everybody disdains, not simply for the fact that it's not so complex, but also because it had bad politics, right? So it was a bit like, you know, walking with my head down and all that kind of rubbish. But as I've spent as many years as I have with Ramayana, which is 30 years now, it's 2014, it's 30 years. You can't talk about one of the epics without talking about the other. I mean, they are, as Ramanujan pointed out, profoundly intertextual. And you can't understand fully one of the epics unless you know the other. And I've actually come to the conclusion that it's the Ramayana that is more complex and more challenging, because in Mahabharata what happens is people are not sure what is the right thing. And so they make mistakes. In Ramayana, Rama knows what is the right thing. He does it. And it all goes terribly wrong. So you are called upon to think far more deeply about what you imagine is the right thing. It may not be the obvious one. You know, when he has to... And Kaikeyi tells him, you have to go into the forest for 14 years, it's your father's wish. And he says, okay. And then he goes to Kaushalya and he says, you know, this is what my father wishes and I'm going to do it. And she says, how can you, why? And he said, because it is my dharma to obey my father. And she said, well, what about your dharma to make your mother happy? Why is your dharma to your father more important than yours to me? And Sita says, what about me? Don't you have a dharma towards me as well? So in Ramayana, all your good dharmas, all the good things that you can do are actually in conflict with each other in a way that they're not in Mahabharata. In Mahabharata, there's the right thing and there's the wrong thing. And poor people in the Mahabharata, they don't know what is the right thing. In Ramayana, we all know what is right. We do it with, the, with you know, with incredible sincerity, and then it goes wrong, then what kind of a world is that, you know? I think it offers a much more challenging idea of how difficult it is to be human. Forget being good, you know?
I take it there are no further questions. So just to conclude, I heard some very profound things from Arshia, and I've been doing that for 30 years. So this is just a continuation of a very old story that began on the parapet of Elphinstone College and Sydenham College. One of the things she said is the quest between remembering and forgetting, and what forgetting can do when about the whole idea of glimpse divinity. The other profound thing I got was about how unhappy he must be to be so cruel, that the roots of cruelty lie in unhappiness and not necessarily pride. And the most interesting was, of course, that when you want to do right, things go wrong. Unintended consequences is what we do know. But what is the right when you want to do something right and you want to go by that path, but the consequences are beyond that? And that tells us what she finally said, how difficult it is to be human. So thank you for the book.
Thank you both for this insightful session. We would now request Mr. Altaf Tairwala to give a token of appreciation to Mr. Salil Tripathi and Ms. Arshia Sattar.
I saw you in the hard bag.